Hi, I'm Daniel Köhn from the Institute of Geoscience at Christian Albrechts University Kiel. Welcome to my talk, Challenges a Near-Surface 2D SH Full Waveform Inversion Field Data Applications. Since 2014, we have applied the full waveform inversion approach quite successfully to a wide range of field data applications, from very simple problems, like this layer over half space problem, to very complex media, including surface topography, 3D fractured media with thrust folds. Typically, these applications are related to archaeological prospection and engineering geophysics. Over the last 8 years, we gathered a lot of experience in the field of near-surface full waveform field data applications. So today I want to discuss some of the challenges that we encountered. Some of them are already solved, while others will require some additional brain power to find reasonable solutions. Before I begin with the talk, I want to thank my growing list of contributors to the full waveform inversion research at Kiel University. These are not only geophysicists, but cover a wide range of research areas, like, for example, archaeology, geology, and geography. So thank you to all these guys who contributed in one form or another to the full waveform inversion field data applications. Now, due to the time constraints of this talk, I cannot deliver a comprehensive introduction to the full waveform inversion method. Therefore, I compiled some nice open access waveform inversion tutorials from the Seiscope Consortium, the Seismic Laboratory for Imaging and Modeling, or short SLIM, at the University of British Columbia, and, of course, my own lectures at Kiel University. So let's start with the waveform inversion challenge number one. Seismic wave propagation in the near surface is often significantly affected by intrinsic damping of the medium. Therefore, a viscoelastic description of the medium is required. In the following field data example, I want to demonstrate the influence of the viscoelastic medium, especially on the dispersion of LAF waves. If you're interested in further details, I refer to this paper from 2019. The field data for this example was acquired as part of the DFG Special Priority Program 1630, Harbors from the Roman Period to the Middle Ages. Well, this smells like a lot of history and archaeology, and indeed we had a very nice cooperation between geophysics and archaeology, where we applied all our knowledge in geophysical prospection to different locations all over Europe. This cooperation was the unique opportunity for ground truthing, because the archaeologists actually excavated some of our seismic profiles. Now, one example that I want to show here is the medieval Fossa Carolina Canal, or Karlsgraben in German. Located in southern Germany near Nuremberg, its purpose was to connect the Rhine River system with the Danube River system, which allows trade or conducting wars from the North Sea all over the Baltic Sea. The construction of the canal was initiated in 793 AD by the Franconian king Charlemagne. In this artistic sketch from the 16th century, you can see that the artist obviously had absolutely no idea about the engineering challenges related to the canal construction. So first of all, the canal was not only 5 meters long, something like that, but actually 2 kilometers. The construction also required a little bit more than only 4 workers, and furthermore, the soil was not really ideal to dug a canal. Nevertheless, some parts of the canal still exist today and are still accessible. Notice also the original boat from King Charlemagne floating around over here. Other parts look like this, so no visible canal at all, only flat, grassy, green areas, ideal to apply a nice firework of different geophysical methods, from magnetics, geoelectrics, to radar, and of course SH seismics. Now, the fundamental question from the archaeologists was, can we actually derive the canal basement structure by SH full waveform inversion? This information is quite important in order to get significant insight into the construction phase of the canal. So let's see what we can learn about the subsurface by the application of SH full waveform inversion. Here you can see one of the nice raw SH shot gathers. Well, actually it's not 100% raw data. We applied a low pass filter to the data with a maximum frequency of 80 Hz. But still a really impressive data quality with no visible noise, up to maximum offsets of about 36 meters. You can see nicely the direct wave and refracted wave. Notice that the arrival times of the refracted wave is significantly delayed in the area of the canal, simply because the canal filling consists of soil with very low S-wave velocities. So, if the task would be find the location of the Fossa Carolina canal, we don't have to apply any sophisticated full waveform inversion, but instead simply take a look into the raw data and say, here is the canal. So, mission accomplished. Now, beside the refracted wave, you can also see a very dispersive Laugh wave. And notice how the amplitude of the Laugh wave is quite significantly damped after passing the canal structure. This is already a first indicator that intrinsic damping of the medium, so viscoelastic medium properties, have to be incorporated into our waveform inversion. In total, the acquisition geometry consists of 47 sources and 48 receivers distributed on a 36 meter long profile. Now, because the used waveform inversion approach is based on a local optimization method, an initial model is required. In this case, we estimated this model by first arrival travel time tomography. As you can see, this model extends to a depth of about 6 meters and has a lateral extension of 36 meters. A near surface layer with a thickness of approximately 1 meter shows very low shear wave velocities, between 50 and 100 meters per second. You can also see the canal structure. And below this low velocity layer, we have a medium that consists approximately of a homogeneous half space with S-wave velocities of about 250 meters per second and some high velocity anomalies varying between 325 and 450 meters per second. To check the quality of this first arrival tomography result, I calculated some synthetic travel time data using my Iconar solver and compared the picked travel times, shown here in red, with the modeled travel times, shown here in yellow. So you can see that the field data is really nicely fitted for the first arrival travel time tomography, for the first shot, and also here for the last shot of the data set. So this might be a good starting point for the waveform inversion. Before we run to the next supercomputer to start the inversion and wait for a few days to get a high-resolution model of the subsurface, it might be a good idea to calculate also synthetic seismic waveforms beside the simple travel time comparison. So I used a very simple 2D finite difference code to solve the 2D SH problem for the velocity model, which was derived from the first arrival travel time tomography. And here you can see a seismogram comparison of the first shot of the data set. So the black wiggles denote the field data set, while the modeled data is shown in red. Now, if you look at this comparison, you might think, what kind of nonsense model have you produced with the first arrival travel time tomography? Well, you can see a laugh wave. It is not as dispersive as the field data, and it is also not damped at all after passing the Fossa Carolina canal. The first arrival waveform is also not visible in the model data. It's completely missing. So, what is the problem? Well, we ignored a very important property of the near surface soil, and that is the intrinsic damping. So, let's assume we can approximate the viscoelastic properties of the medium by a homogeneous half-space model with a constant quality factor QS of about 30. Now, if we compare the elastic with the viscoelastic modeling result, the first arrival waveforms start to appear, while the laugh waveform amplitude is still too strong after passing the canal. So let's reduce QS to 15. Now the modeled first arrival waveform seems to fit the waveform in the field data quite nicely. However, the laugh waveform is still a little bit too strong after passing the canal. So let's decrease QS even more, let's say to 10. Now the laugh wave damping after passing the canal seem to be almost perfect. And take a look at this. There's a quite significant difference in the damping between QS equals 10 and QS equals 15. So forget about all the sophisticated amplitude over offset analysis or spectral division methods to estimate a reasonable QS model. In this case, we simply have to compute synthetic seismograms, modify the constant Q model until the waveform fit between the modeled and the field data is minimal. Okay, with our new viscoelastic initial model, we can start our first full waveform inversion run on our supercomputer, wait a few days, and would get a completely nonsense inversion result, because the waveform inversion will not converge at all. What's the reason for that? Well, notice how the first arrival waveform arrives in the modeled data earlier than in the field data, leading to a significant cycle skipping, so the full waveform inversion is not able to converge at all. And the reason for this strange behavior is the very low QS value, leading to a significant dispersion of the refracted wave, and therefore a shift of the first arrival waveform. So this Q-related dispersion effect has to be corrected by changing the velocity model. If we correct the dispersion effect, the modeled first arrival waveform fits the field data in terms of amplitude and phases very well. Looking at the LAV waveform fit, well, there is some room for improvements, but actually that should be achieved by the full waveform inversion. As I mentioned before, we had this really fruitful cooperation with the archaeologists who excavated our seismic profiles. So we have the unique opportunity to compare the waveform inversion results with the subsurface structures. And first we received this excavation sketch from the archaeologists, which shows some interesting features. So notice that the complex shape of the canal basement is defined by this black organic rich layer, which is very prominent in the sketch. Now, in order to compare features of the first arrival travel time tomography and waveform inversion results, I simply superimposed the S-wave velocity models as semi-transparent images over the excavation sketch. And the comparison with the first arrival travel time tomography result is dominated by a simple velocity gradient showing some correlation with the canal basement. And the FAT model is also lacking any small-scale details, especially inside the canal. And this lack of resolution can only be improved by the full waveform inversion, where quite more obvious velocity gradient follows very well the canal basement shape. And also within the canal, we can see multiple small-scale structures. However, the archaeological sketch is obviously quite subjective, so we would prefer a more objective comparison. And luckily, we also have a photograph of the excavation down to a depth of about 1.5 meters. As in the excavation sketch, the canal basement is defined by dark organic rich material. The soil below the canal basement shows a light yellow color, and the canal filling consists basically of three soil layers. So on top we have this dark orange layer, then we have a gray layer and another dark orange layer. And the first 0.5 meters below the surface is actually dominated by a gray weathering layer with large thermal cracks that you can see over here. Now, to compare the inversion result with the excavation photo, I superimposed the full waveform inversion S-wave velocity model on the photo. To get an idea about the velocity range covered by the different colors here, the dark red is about 50 meters per second, the light red is 100 meters per second, while the green and yellow colors represent about 150 meters per second. Now, due to the image plot, we can't see the photo anymore, so comparison is a little bit complicated. So I replaced the image plot by a contour plot for an easier comparison of the photo with the full waveform inversion result. Notice again how the canal basement is defined by a quite significant velocity gradient. Below the canal, the S-wave velocities are significantly higher, by 50 to 100 meters per second, so these yellow and green colors over here. And inside the canal, you can see that this dark or orange layer over here correlates quite nicely with this 50 meter per second S-wave velocity anomaly. While this 100 meter per second anomaly here correlates with the gray layer almost perfectly. However, there are also some exemptions. For example, you can see that this 100 meter per second high velocity anomaly is shifted upwards compared to the gray layer. The question is the reason for this actually this rabbit hole over here, which reduces the shear modulus and therefore also reduces the S-wave velocity in this area? Now, I don't want to compare rabbit holes with waveform inversion results, but maybe that's the reason why the anomaly is actually shifted upwards. The top part of the model, well, it correlates not really 100% with the weathering layer, but interestingly, you have some correlation with these thermal cracks in the surface. Now, obviously, these cracks can lead to a shear modulus reduction and consequently to low S-wave velocities of about 50 meters per second in this area. There are also two high velocity anomalies within the weathering layer which we cannot really explain. So maybe these are inversion artifacts related to SH to P converted waves traveling perpendicular to the 2D SH profile. But more generally, you should be very cautious when comparing soil colors with physical properties like shear modulus, because there is in most cases not necessarily a perfect correlation between these two properties. So keep this in mind when comparing full waveform inversion results with archaeological excavations. So, in the last challenge, we have seen the importance of including viscoelastic effects into our full waveform inversion workflow. We have also acquired the seismic data at a location with a very flat topography. The next challenge is to incorporate significant surface topography in our full waveform inversion workflow. And I want to discuss problems related to this by using examples from a very nice master thesis by Manuel Zolcho, which will be published later this year. So what are typical problems with significant surface topography? In archaeogeophysics, interesting problems with significant topography are burial mounds, like this example, the Yigma Tepe from Pergamon in Turkey. And if you're more interested in engineering geophysics, another example with strong surface topography are dikes, like this one from the west coast in northern Germany. Dikes have another really nice property. They are more or less two-dimensional structures extending almost to infinity, at least in northern Germany, where they vanish in the mist here near the horizon. So, to demonstrate the challenges related to surface topography, I want to focus on the full waveform inversion of an SH data set acquired on the Dannewerk. Well, you might now ask, what is the Dannewerk? Here you can see an old map from 1539 by Olaus Magnus covering the North Sea and Baltic Sea area. For orientation, let me show you some familiar major cities. For example, here is Hamburg, here is Lübeck. Oh, and here is Kiel with its famous castle. At the border between Denmark and northern Germany, you can see a very prominent defensive fortification wall extending from the Baltic Sea to the North Sea. This is the Dannewerk, originally built by the Vikings at some time before 500 AD, So actually it's the Great Chinese Wall equivalent in northern Germany. But unfortunately it's not that well known and not that really spectacular, as you can see in this photo over here. So you have a wall, a little bit of grass and some trees. So only some unspectacular ruins are left of this fortification wall. However, from a geophysical perspective, it is quite interesting because this fortification consists not only of soil, but also contains a brickstone wall, as you can see in this photo, leading to significant physical parameter contrasts in the subsurface. Now, this slide summarizes the different phases of the Dannewerk construction history. So, at some time before 500 AD, the Vikings started with a very small, simple wall and a trench in front of it. And maybe due to different wars, the Dannewerk was then significantly extended in size. Over the centuries, the fortification was improved then by a wooden fence that you can see here. And then the wooden fence was obviously not strong enough, so there was a cobblestone wall added. And in 1170 AD, King Valdemar I added a massive brickstone wall. And actually, 800 years later, the Dannewerk was reactivated in the Danish-German War in 1864. However, I don't know how effective it actually was, because massive cannons were quite common at this time. Now, two archaeogeophysical questions related to the Dannewerk are quite interesting. First, can we detect the cobblestone and the brickstone walls by geophysical methods? And second, can we distinguish between the different construction phases of the Dannewerk? As you can see, in the first stage, the wall was quite small and then grows significantly over time. Now, before we discuss these questions, let's come back to the problem with the surface tomography. So, Manuel Zolchow estimated a S-wave velocity model using a first arrival travel time tomography from the SH data acquired over the topography of the Dannewerk. And within the Dannewerk, you can see some diffuse high-velocity anomalies in an otherwise gradual velocity increase from the surface to the bottom. Now, in order to use this model in a computer, we have to discretize it. And because our modeling code solved the viscoelastic equations of motion using the finite difference method on a 2D Cartesian grid, we can run into a very significant problem when using a very coarse model discretization. As you can see, when discretizing the model with a special grid point distance of 20 centimeters, the surface topography is approximated by these artificial steps. You might think, what's the big issue? Well, if you try to compute seismic wave fields with such an undersampled model, significant Laugh wave reflections and diffractions will occur. And during the full waveform inversion, these artifacts in the modeled wave field will prohibit a successful convergence of the inversion. So, what can we do about this problem? There exist two very sophisticated mathematical solutions and one not so sophisticated but quite effective approach. So, let's first shortly discuss the two mathematically ambitious approaches. So first, you can deform surface boundary of the Cartesian mesh according to the surface topography. And this can be achieved by the so-called transfinite interpolation. If you're interested in the details of this approach, I've linked a YouTube video from my seismic modeling lecture regarding this topic. The other approach is to discretize the model with a triangular instead of a Cartesian mesh, which follows the surface topography and which can then later on be used to solve the forward problem with a finite element or finite volume method. Again, for further information, I linked a YouTube video over here. Now, what is the not very sophisticated approach? Well, very simple. You oversample the subsurface model. At the top, you can see the specially undersampled model with 20 centimeters grid distance, leading to these step artifacts and then subsequently to artificial surface wave reflections. Now, if we oversample the model with a grid point distance of 5 centimeters, the discretization artifacts are significantly mitigated, and therefore also the related impact on the modeled Love waveforms. This approach is quite easy to implement because we don't have to change anything in our modeling code, but only change the model discretization, which is very easy to do. An obvious disadvantage of this approach, however, are significantly longer computation times for the wave field modeling due to the larger spatial grid. But if you have enough computation power, as of course we have at Keele University, this is actually not an issue. So oversampling is one part of this approach. The other is to consider how to implement an accurate free surface boundary condition. And this can be achieved by assuming vacuum properties above the surface topography and then apply some special numerical tricks in order to avoid numerical singularities in the finer different codes. So for further details, I added here a link to a very nice paper by Judy Pan et al. 2018. Now we can accurately model Love wave propagation in the presence of strong surface topography and run our full waveform inversion. And then also turn our attention to challenge number 3. So, how can we estimate optimum smoothness constraints for waveform inversion? In full waveform inversion, or more generally any inversion approach, the application of smoothness constraints is absolutely essential. If we apply no smoothness constraints, we get this result you see over here. Now, you might think that we have resolved a lot of details in the wall. Looks really interesting. Yeah, for example, you can see here individual stones or boulders or something like that, which the archaeologists only have to excavate. However, if you analyze the result a little bit more closely, you will see that these stones are actually located near source and receiver positions, which would be quite interesting coincidence. Notice also that most of the near surface features look like bananas. For example, this one over here or this one. You can also see bananas here. And these bananas connecting source and receiver positions. So these structures are actually not stones. They are not real. But what they show is the footprint of the acquisition geometry. And if you introduce artificial structures here at the surface of the model, forget about all the structures that you see at the deeper parts, because the deeper part update is influenced by the structures at the near surface parts. So we have to impose smoothness constraints, otherwise we get completely silly inversion results. So, to impose smoothness constraints, two approaches can be applied. So, approach number one, introduce penalty terms in the objective function, which are a measure of the model roughness. So, this can be, for example, the L1 norm of the Laplacian of the S-wave velocity model. And when you minimize the objective function during the waveform inversion, you minimize first the data misfit and also the model roughness. The idea behind the second approach is to precondition the model update by applying a 2D special Gaussian filter, where the correlation length S is adapted to a fraction beta of the local S-wave lengths, defined by the local S-wave velocity divided by the maximum frequency of the inverted data set. So this factor beta controls the amount of smoothening and can be defined independently in X and Z direction. So let's test the influence of the smoothness constraints on the full waveform inversion result. First, we assume an equal beta of 0.5 in X and Z direction. This means we only smooth structures below about half of the local wavelengths, which is typically the resolution limit of the waveform inversion. In the resulting S-wave velocity model, you see the high frequency inversion artifacts are significantly suppressed. Yeah, no more boulders are visible. And actually, you also see more coherent layers or layer interfaces are appearing. However, you can still see some banana artifacts, for example, here. If you look more closely all over here near the surface, which are again related to the acquisition footprint. So to suppress these artifacts even further, we fix the beta in Z direction to 0.5, while systematically increasing the beta in X direction to 1, 1.25 and 1.5 respectively. Obviously, in case of beta equals 1.5, we lose a quite significant amount of resolution. So a lot of small-scale structures are now missing. The effect of beta x equals 1 and 1.25 are comparable, showing even more coherent layer interfaces and even less banana artifacts. For example, here is a very incoherent layer, incoherent structure, which seemed to be a little bit more coherent in these two inversion results. So the challenge is, how do we choose the optimum beta? There are mathematical approaches like the L-curve analysis, which in this case completely fails because no distinct L-curve is actually visible. In most cases, I try to find the right balance between model resolution and suppression of inversion artifacts, so especially these banana artifacts, simply by visual inspection of the full waveform inversion results. So in this case, I would choose a beta x of 1 or 1.25. Now let's go over to the last challenge. Challenge number 4 is, how reproducible are full waveform inversion results? Well, this is a very complex but very important question, especially if you want to interpret details in your full waveform inversion result. Unfortunately, it's not easy to answer that question. Here I only want to discuss one aspect of this question. At the Dannewerk, we acquired SH data by dropping a hammer onto a shear wave anchor. Obviously, you can drop the hammer either from the left or the right hand side against the anchor. leading to two data sets with different polarity. And here you can see these two data sets acquired with exactly the same acquisition geometry, but different polarity of the source excitation. Again, black seismograms denote the field data and the red seismograms the model data set. In case of the top data set, we excited from the left side, and at the bottom data set, we excited from the right side. Notice the change in the polarity of the waveform, especially seen here at the near surface trace in the synthetic data. It's an obvious polarity change in the source wavelet. Now, Manuel has inverted both data sets separately with the same inversion parameters and smoothness constraints, and the red modeled seismograms demonstrate the accurate waveform fit by the full waveform inversion. So in both cases, you can see that the first arrival and the LARV waveforms could be fitted about equally well. And of course, the interesting question is now, how do the full waveform inversion models look like? Well, here they are. The top full waveform inversion result is based on the data set with source excitation from the left side. The bottom result was inverted from the data set with excitation from the right side. And areas with low model resolution are marked by these semi-transparent boxes. So you should ignore actually the features that you see in these boxes. However, near the surface, we can see comparable structures in both models, like this low velocity layer here on top. Then intermediate S-wave velocities within the wall of about 200 meters per second. Or this near-surface high-velocity anomaly, which also occurs in both inversion results. In other parts, you can see some differences. For example, this high-velocity anomaly over here is shifted downwards a little bit in this waveform inversion result. Or here appears a high-velocity anomaly, which is missing in this inversion result, or at least it is a little bit rearranged. So while the acquisition geometry is exactly the same and we only changed one small piece in the problem, the source excitation, we get very similar but not exactly identical for waveform inversion results. So keep this in mind when you interpret details in your full waveform inversion model. Now, in case of the Dannewerk, we have the unique opportunity for ground truthing the inversion results, because parts of the wall were excavated in 1991. So at the bottom, you can see an excavation photo from Andersen 1998. The most interesting features are marked by these red letters. For example, W1, W2, and W3 denote the different early construction phases of the Dannewerk. Remember, first it was a small wall consisting of soil, which was growing over the centuries in size. So W1 belongs to the oldest part of the Dannewerk construction, and W3 was added later on in the last part of this construction phase, and you can really see the old shape of the Dannewerk here in this photo. Additionally, the wall was extended in lateral direction, leading to a partial collapse of the wall, which is visible as this funnel structure that you can see over here. And the parts D and F denote the youngest parts of the Dannewerk, so there was actually material added later on. And you can see that most of the features from the excavation photo are also visible in the full waveform inversion result. So the early construction phases W1, W2, W3 consist of soil with intermediate S-wave velocities between 150 and 200 meters per second. Yeah, you can see this in this part of the inversion result. In the funnel structure denoted by R, the velocities drop down to 50 meters per second. Yeah, and so you see really here the different features from the archaeological excavation photos. And beyond that, we see that here are two high velocity anomalies, A and B, with velocities up to 400 meters per second. And these can be actually related to basement structures consisting of cobblestones, which should avoid a further collapse of the Dannewerk. Yeah, you can imagine if we add here some basement structures, we add some stability to the Dannewerk to avoid any further collapse. But as usual, this interesting part of the full waveform inversion was actually not extensively excavated by the archaeologists. Too bad. In the classical first arrival travel time tomography, we can actually not see any of these structures, only a velocity gradient and this diffuse high velocity anomaly over here. So it is quite impressive how the waveform inversion is able to resolve and distinguish most of the features which are visible in the excavation photo. Especially you could distinguish the different construction phases, at least to some extent, of the Dannewerk. So that was one important question by the archaeologists. The other question was, can we resolve the cobblestone and brickstone walls? And luckily, parts of the Dannewerk containing intact walls were also excavated, as you can see in this photo. And as in the previous example, W1, W2 and W3 denote the early construction phases of the Dannewerk, where it was growing in size, which can again be correlated to intermediate S-wave velocities between 150 and 200 meters per second in the waveform inversion result. Really nice. Now, S here denotes the remains of the cobblestone wall, which is also visible in the waveform inversion result with S-wave velocities of about 200 meters per second. Yeah, the shape is quite nicely resolved. The compact brickstone wall, denoted here by F, which was built by King Valdemar I, can be characterized by higher S-wave velocities of about 300 meters per second. So again, a very impressive demonstration of the potential of the full waveform inversion method as a tool in archaeological prospection. You can also distinguish other features, which are quite interesting, but unfortunately I'm running out of time. So now, if I could spark your interest in full waveform inversion field data applications and you want to try it out by yourself, I can recommend our open source software package covering essentially all steps from data pre-processing to first arrival travel time tomography and finally waveform inversion. So this package can be downloaded from my GitHub homepage. We are also working on reproducible packages, which wrap together the raw field data and all the required software packages. And most importantly, all steps from data preprocessing to the full waveform inversion result are documented step by step, so that the whole waveform inversion workflow is transparent and reproducible by anyone. And of course, the data and the packages will be also open source. Again, I want to thank all the developers and contributors to this software package. It is a really nice experience to develop open source software when you receive sometimes small and sometimes very, very large contributions to your code. So some people have invested a lot of time into code optimization here. So I want to thank all these developers and contributors. And finally, I want to thank the usual suspects for financial support, the Computing Center at Kiel University, where we can run our computationally ambitious modeling and waveform inversion codes, and finally you for your attention. Thank you very much.